Welcome to In the Word, a study of the International Bible School lesson. Join Dr. Lee Magnus, Professor Emeritus of Bible, and Dr. Bill Gwaltney, Professor Emeritus of Bible, both from Milligan College, as they bring you their thoughts and knowledge of the study of the Sunday School lesson for the day. Now, here is Dr. Gwaltney.
Dr. Magnus and I welcome you to our study, our continuing study about the prophet Jonah, a little four-chapter book in among the larger books of the prophets, and it's in the form of a short story, which is the only prophetic book, Lee, that is a short story in form. So this is an unusual writing.
It is. It's also unusual because the prophet himself isn't exactly the hero of the story. He's the main character.
He's the main character, but not a hero.
But not exactly the hero. And as we saw in the first chapter, he didn't spend much of his time evangelizing those pagan sailors on the ship. Instead, he was hiding out down in the hold of the ship while they were on the deck praying, which he should have been doing. And now we're going to see a different side of Jonah in chapter 2 in today's lesson.
Absolutely. So now we will even change for just a little short time the form of,
I'm
literature.
Sure most of our viewers will look at their Bibles and see a different literary form. It looks different on the printed page, and for good reason. Chapter 2 is a poem.
Yes.
And
very much like one of the Psalms.
Right. I think if you took this and stuck it over into the Psalms, most of us wouldn't know the difference.
We would not be surprised.
It sounds just like a psalm. And it sounds especially like a certain kind of psalm. In fact, a very common kind of psalm called a lament.
Yes.
And
personal lament.
Personal lament. And
right.
It's very important, I think, to understand. I know I was greatly benefited when I learned from you some years ago. That a lament always includes two kinds of expression. And the first is an expression of despair or complaint, or
yes,
involves some kind of a cry for help in the midst of a bad situation.
You know what just popped into my mind?
No.
Was a gospel song. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore.
Well, Jonah was sinking deep in something here. I guess you could call it sin, because he hadn't exactly cooperated with the will of God, had he?
That's right. So he complains about sinking deep.
He does.
In the water.
And he complains that he's losing his life. But there's another important theme in this lament in every lament. And how would you express that other theme?
Well, confidence in God.
Oh.
God is there. God is concerned. God is capable of intervening. And so you throw yourself on God's mercy, and we're even going to have that very special word that's used in many translations for mercy in our text here today.
Mm-hmm. Here it's translated love.
Love, yes.
Yeah, we'll get to it. So so you're saying it's possible, or it's not only possible, it's common, to have a deep and abiding trust, even though in the moment you're crying out in despair and in,
exactly,
in difficulty.
Exactly. Yeah. And we learn a lot about how to deal with difficulty and pain, sorrow, and distress from these Psalms.
Yeah.
It's very, very true to life.
It is. And I'll tell you, it was very liberating for me to recognize that over half the Psalms are exactly like this in their lament style. And the reason it was liberating is that I think I grew up with a kind of notion that if there was any chink in your spiritual armor, that is, if you you were confused about God, or
complaining,
things were going bad, yeah. And you're saying, God, why me, or why did you do this? That somehow represented a loss of faith, and actually that's not true.
And God would be displeased.
Yeah, it is possible to have this confusion about what God is doing in our lives in the context of a deep and abiding trust.
Right.
Kind of a, I believe, help my unbelief,
or right.
something like that.
Well, another characteristic of God in all of this is that God can be reasoned with.
Mm-hmm.
I take, for an example, Abraham dealing with God over the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities of the around the Dead Sea.
Yeah.
Will you save the city if there are 50 righteous? And then he got God down to 10, mm-hmm. and he quit. He quit too soon.
Yeah. Well, and Jeremiah does kind of the same thing. He goes running around through Jerusalem looking for a righteous person, hoping that, you know, God will spare them if there's someone who's righteous.
Well, and that's a good thing for us to consider in our own time, that the righteous few sometimes give reason for the survival of a culture, or a city, or a social unit.
Right. Well, at any rate,
you never know the power of a righteous person.
Mm-hmm.
Just one. Even.
Mm-hmm. Well, and James refers to the prayer of a righteous person having great effect.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. Well, so this is a psalm, it's a poem, and
now,
it's a psalm of lament.
You know, where's the fish in all of this?
Well, he mentions being in the belly of everything but a fish, pretty much, doesn't he?
Well, it sounds like he's outside.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like our space people up there who have to wander outside of the safety of the unit itself.
Mm-hmm.
And it almost sounds like he's, or is this a reflection on what he endured before the fish got him?
Before the fish, yeah. That raises an interesting question. If he's crying out like this from within the fish, it makes it sound like the fish is a place of danger. But on the other hand,
well, if I got swallowed by a fish, I would think that I was really in danger.
Yes, but the irony is that the fish was actually a means of rescue.
Yes.
So both things are true at the same time, aren't they? That there's a certain kind of discipline involved in the fish from which he wants to escape. But there's also deliverance for Jonah involved
like
in the fish.
Like going to the hospital.
You don't want to go, but it...
And it's a dangerous place.
It's a dangerous place, but you can be delivered from a lot of pain.
But it can be, yes.
Yeah, that's true. Well, at any rate. All right, I think you get to read this beautiful chapter for us.
Yes,
you get to read the whole chapter. Okay, good.
From inside the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God. He said, "In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. From deep in the realm of the dead, I called for help, and you listened to my cry. You hurled me into the depths, into the very heart of the seas, and the currents swirled about me. All your waves and breakers swept over me. I said, I have been banished from your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The engulfing waters threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the roots of the mountains I sank down. The earth beneath barred me in forever. But you, Lord my God, brought my life up from the pit. When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you, to your holy temple. Those who cling to worthless idols turn away from God's love for them. but I, with shouts of grateful praise, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will make good. I will say, salvation comes from the Lord. And the Lord commanded the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. A few things, I think, in the translation that need to be clarified just a little bit. Going back to verse 2, in my distress I called to the Lord, and he answered me from the realm of the dead is actually the term Sheol.
Yeah, that's a term and a concept that I think all students of the Bible need to know. It's a Hebrew word, Sheol.
Exactly what it means. It's hard to imagine. It looks like it comes from a verbal root in Hebrew and other Semitic languages, meaning to ask a question.
Huh.
But I don't think that's it.
Yeah.
I had one of my best friends in graduate school wrote a dissertation on the meaning of Sheol.
Huh.
And you know what his conclusion was?
No.
We don't know.
So it's hard to figure out the literal meaning of the word, but we do know what it refers to.
We know how they used it.
Yeah,
yes.
How they used it. And what they used it to describe, and so this is not a bad translation in the NRV, in the NIV, is the place of the dead, or
yes,
the realm of the dead, or more generally, death itself.
Well, and let's put together with that the Greek concept, mm-hmm, that we find that's sort of parallel to it.
Mm-hmm.
We have the word Hades.
Hades, place of the dead. And what's hard, I think, for many Christians and students of the teachings of Jesus and the New Testament to understand is that this concept of heaven and hell that's so prominent in the New Testament really did not exist in the ancient Hebrew teachings about death.
There was a valley of the Hinnom, mm-hmm, but of the sons of Hinnom,
mm-hmm,
which we know. I've been on a bus tour that went right through there,
and it that becomes kind of the model of Gehenna.
I like
hell.
To say, well, I've
been
to hell,
hell
and back.
You've been to hell and back, huh?
Gehenna, that is.
Yeah, right.
But we know what it was. It was, mm-hmm, an area for the burial of the dead.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And in fact, the oldest inscription we have of the Bible is a little rolled up amulet of silver with a priestly benediction on it, which came out of a tomb found mm-hmm, in the Valley of Hinnom.
Mm-hmm. So, but this whole notion of a place of reward and a place of punishment after death was really foreign to the thinking of the ancient Israelite people.
No, you did go to some place, and you might have some consciousness, but it wasn't. It was a very gloomy, dusty, and not desirable, mm-hmm, kind of life that you lived in their minds.
Yeah.
Not like the Egyptian concept whatsoever.
Okay. So that's the idea of Sheol, and that's the word that's used, that's translated realm of the dead in chapter 2, verse 2.
That's right.
Yeah.
Now, over in verse 7, when my life was fainting away, I remembered the you is not in the text.
Mm-hmm.
This is making something very personal out of a statement that I remembered the Lord, mm-hmm, is just what the text says.
Yeah. The next
it's not
line,
addressing God.
The next line does mention you, doesn't it? My prayer rose to you.
Yes, it does.
Yeah. And this is an interesting phenomenon that we see throughout this poem and many, many others. And that is a kind of a constant moving back and forth from referring to the Lord in the third person.
Yes.
And then referring to the Lord as you in the second person.
It's sort of like a conversation at this point is I speaking to you.
Okay.
The I-thou relationship,
mm-hmm, yeah,
that is involved.
Well,
but sometimes it is kind of standing off and looking at God and remembering how God is speaking about God in the third person.
To other people.
Yes.
Yeah. The same thing occurs over in verse 2. In my distress, I called to the Lord. That's third person. He answered me. From deep in the realm of the dead, I called for help, and you listened to my cry.
The same little trick. It's a poetic characteristic and trick. Is in the 23rd Psalm.
Uh-huh.
Many, many other psalms.
Right, right.
Now, we got to go down to verse 8, because there is this term that is so full of meaning, that God's love for them, that's a difficult line to translate. Mm.
But we do know the word that's used for love there is what, the Hebrew word there?
It's chesed. Just two syllables, and sometimes you'll see it H-E-S-E-D mm-hmm. in English, and sometimes you'll see it C-H-E-S-E-D. The C-H is a way of saying it's a guttural.
But you don't say ch.
No.
Ch, like in church.
Just pronounce it like it's an H.
Chesed. This is an important word, perhaps the single most important word in the Old Testament to describe the character of God.
Well, I did a study of how many times does it show up in the latter prophets and found 27 times, and this is one of them.
Just in the small prophetic books.
No, in Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel,
Isaiah,
and 12.
Isaiah through Malachi. Okay.
The so-called latter prophets.
Yeah.
Now I've completed a study of it in the Psalms, the book of Psalms, and there are 125 occurrences.
125 times this word appears in the 150 Psalms. This is a very important word.
The problem is English translations will use over two dozen different English words to translate it.
Yeah. You say that's a problem, but that also shows the richness of this word.
Exactly.
And its breadth of meaning.
Exactly.
Compassion, kindness, loving kindness.
Loyalty.
Yeah.
Covenant-keeping love.
Covenant love, mercy. So just all kinds of, just the very best of God's nature is in this word. While we're in verse 8 talking about God's mercy and covenant love.
You know, this verse is a difficult verse. Mm-hmm. It is very simply this. Let me give a literal translation of it. Those that hang on to worthless, empty things, they abandon their chesed.
Okay.
That's a literal translation of it. Now, what are the worthless things? Well, it's an interpretation to say that they're idols.
Yeah. And I think that's helpful to point out. The word idols is not there. That's been interpreted into the text.
Right.
What is there is the concept of worthlessness, emptiness, vanity, like in the Ecclesiastes.
Who does this pronoun there, T-H-E-I-R, who is it referring to?
Yeah, when I read it, just the way it is in our English text, mentioning idols, I assume that while Jonah is in the midst of this difficulty here, crying out to God for deliverance, he all of a sudden turns and starts bashing the Gentiles for their idolatry.
And sometimes laments do that.
Okay.
But not all the time.
Yeah, but there's a sense in which that doesn't make sense. And the fact the word idols isn't there at all. So what he's talking about is kind of woe to anyone who clings to worthless and empty things rather than putting their focus on God.
And God's mercy.
And God's mercy.
Yes.
And that...
That could be the Israelites.
That could be the Israelites. In fact, during the time that Jonah lived in the northern kingdom there, that was not a time of great faithfulness to Yahweh.
No.
In fact, the reign of Jeroboam II was characterized by a lot of the same idolatry and unfaithfulness that we saw back during the time of Ahab and Jezebel.
Right. Ahab and Jezebel were unusually bad about this because she was an outsider. She was not an Israelite.
And she kind of sponsored the worship of Baal and the other Canaanite gods and goddesses in the land. But it doesn't look like, for all of Jeroboam II's success politically and militarily and probably economically, he didn't seem to do anything to improve the spiritual tenor or the moral tenor.
There's one other verse that just calls for a quick comment, and that's verse 10. And the Lord, it's not commanded, the Lord said, that's it.
But it doesn't tell us what he said.
No.
But we can assume what he said because we know what the fish did, right?
Right.
We know what the fish did, yeah.
So it's a case here where the Lord said to the fish,
dot, dot, dot.
Dot, dot, dot.
Good.
And he vomited Jonah out on dry land.
Yeah.
So what did he say?
Yeah. Now, we talked last week about this concept deliverance, and how we saw in chapter 1 two forms of deliverance.
Yes.
One was the deliverance of the sailors from the storm, which God had hurled at them. The second was the deliverance of Jonah by sending the fish. And this chapter carries on that second theme of the deliverance of Jonah. He's crying out here for deliverance. But he does it, the climax of this poem, this prayer poem, is these words, salvation comes from the Lord.
Exactly.
Deliverance comes from the Lord.
Yeah, there it is, end of verse 9.
Right.
Yes.
The irony, one of the ironies of the book of Jonah is that finally Jonah has started praying in chapter 2.
He we probably all would if we were in his situation.
Probably so. I'm not blaming him for praying in this situation. What strikes me, the reason I call it ironic, is that back on the ship in chapter 1,
in the midst
of this terrible storm,
he didn't pray.
He doesn't utter a word of prayer. It's the pagan sailors. It's the Gentile sailors.
They pray to their gods and they pray to Jonah's God.
Right. They're the ones praying. He's down trying to, in denial, in the hold of the ship.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm not saying that there's something wrong with him praying for his own deliverance. I'm saying that we have what I see here is a tendency in myself to pray when I'm in the midst of a calamity or some fearsome situation.
Right.
And just forget all about praying.
And don't pray any other time.
Not pray any other time, and not pray for other people in their difficulties.
Right.
See, why wasn't he praying for those sailors, that they be rescued? And so there are two challenges here for me. One is to avoid the temptation to only pray earnestly and sincerely when I'm in trouble. And the second is the temptation to only pray for my troubles and not for the needs of others.
I'd like to point out just a very subtle thing in the Hebraic text as we move from chapter 1 into chapter 2, and then from chapter 2 to the rest of the book. Mm-hmm. There is a verb used in chapter 1 at least three times. I'm relying on my memory now, which is to cast down, to cast out.
Mm-hmm.
And that is so negative sounding.
Mm-hmm.
They cast out the cargo. The God cast the storm upon them and so forth. But beginning in the Hebrew text is verse 1, but it was the old verse 17 that we looked at, is a new verb.
Mm.
And the new verb is God appointed.
Mm-hmm.
And it will occur at least four times in the rest of the book.
Yeah.
From casting out to God's appointment.
Yeah.
And God now takes charge.
I'm so glad you brought that up.
Oh, thanks.
One of the great messages of the book of Jonah is that even though circumstances around us may seem chaotic and totally out of anyone's control, like the storm at sea.
Right. And being swallowed by a fish.
And being swallowed by a fish. The message of the book of Jonah is that God is in control of all circumstances.
Yes.
And this word appoint, God appointed a fish. And as you say, we're going to see it throughout the rest of the book.
Right.
He's going to appoint a plant and appoint a worm, and appoint a wind. And so God, that's a great message here, that even in the midst of chaos, we need to put our confidence and trust.
God is at work.
In the overall loving work of God.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, how do we get preserving love here out of this chapter? Mm-hmm. That's our title for this one lesson.
Looking back to chapter one, the lives of the sailors were preserved from the storm. At the very end of chapter one, in verse 17, the life of Jonah appears to be preserved, but now even that agent of rescue, the fish, makes Jonah feel trapped and like he's drowning in the sea, and so he cries out to God's love to preserve him, and turns out that the fish is in fact an agent
of his
preserving
salvation.
His life.
Yeah. And he winds up on dry land.
He does, right back where he would be comfortable.
Well, I don't know where on dry land. Is he back in Joppa? Or is he back closer to his hometown further north? Exactly where on dry land is
this? I read one theory that the fish during the 3 days swam all the way across the Mediterranean, up the Aegean Sea, all the way across the Black Sea, and spit him out up near northern Iraq, up there in Turkey. So we don't know what dry land, and I doubt if Jonah cared much where he was as long as he was
in
dry land.
There's a lot of stories here now. That rivals the rabbinic stories.
Yeah, it does. It does.
they didn't come up with that.
Let me point out the amazing language here, the language of alienation and despair that he has in my distress. I cried for help. All these words.
I'm in the world of the dead.
Yeah, the waves are sweeping over me. The seaweed is wrapped around. This language of entrapment is so strong here. And that's the way we feel sometimes, that life has just got us trapped and we just despair.
Yes.
But at the same time, this poem is filled with the most beautiful statements of trust.
Well, in verse 4, look at the transition.
Yeah, that's a good one.
I've been banished from your sight.
Banished. Yeah.
Yet. Now, yet is an interpretation of the text, but it is certainly implied by the text.
But banished from your sight, but I will look again upon your holy temple, that is the place that symbolized the presence of God among them.
That's the origin of hope.
Yeah.
Well, we are out of time again. As always, more to be said, but we'll come back and we'll look at chapter 3 next week, and we're going to see a rather unhealthy side of the prophet's mind about all of this. So come back and join us as we proceed through the prophet Jonah.
This has been In the Word, a study of the International Bible School lesson with Dr. Lee Magnus, Professor Emeritus of Bible from Milligan College, and Dr. Bill Gwaltney, Professor Emeritus of Bible of Milligan College. Join us again next week for another lesson from the International Bible School lesson text. This has been a production of the First Christian Church Television Ministries.